الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها الأحبة في الله، قد انسلخ العشرون الأول من شهر رمضان، وعما قريب تدخل العشر الأواخر من رمضان، تلك العشر المباركة التي هي أعظم أيام وليالي رمضان فضلا، وأرفعها قدرا، وأكثرها أجرا. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يبلغنا إياها. Two-thirds of the month of Ramadan, the first 20 days, are coming to an end. And very soon, the last 10 days of Ramadan will begin. Those are blessed days, and they are the greatest in virtue and reward from all of these days and nights of Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to deliver us until those last 10 days and nights. حينما ننظر إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وما كان يفعل فيها نجد أحاديث عدة. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها: كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر، يعني العشر الأواخر، أحيا الليل وأيقظ أهله وجد وشد المئزر. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر، وللعلم مساء الغد السبت بعد المغرب تبدأ العشر الأواخر، الليالي العشر الأخيرة من شهر رمضان. إذا دخل العشر أحيا الليل، يعني كان يجتهد في الشهر كله، إلا أنه في العشر الأواخر كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يحرم نفسه من النوم. أحيا الليل وأيقظ أهله، ولم يهمل أهله صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. يعني في الأيام الأول من رمضان إذا كان قائما ووجد أهله نائمين تركهم، ولكن في العشر الأواخر حتى كان يحيي، يعني يوقظ أهله صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. وجد وشد المئزر، يعني اجتهد أكثر، وشد المئزر يعني حتى امتنع عن نسائه صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. When we look at these last 10 days and nights of Ramadan, we find many different ahadith in which we learn of how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent them. Of those, the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha, in which she said, with the start of the last 10 days of Ramadan, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would pray all night. Well, he used to pray in the first 20 nights of Ramadan. He used to pray at night. He used to pray a lot. But in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, he would deprive himself of sleep. And he would stand the entire night in prayer. He would pray all night. And he would wake his family up. Meaning that throughout the month, the first 20 days, if he was praying and his family was sleeping, he would let them be. But in the last 10 nights, because of the great value of those nights, he made sure to awaken his family as well. He used to strive hard in worship, and he used to tighten his waistcloth, meaning that he even abstained from intimacy with his wives during those nights, devoting them to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وكذلك عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يجتهد في العشر الأواخر ما لا يجتهد في غيره صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه. And Aisha radiallahu anha wa ardaha also tells us that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would strive more in the last 10 nights of Ramadan than he would strive in any of the other days of Ramadan. وَكُلُّ ذَلِكَ لِأَنَّهُ عَلِمَ صَلَوَاتُ رَبِّي وَسَلَامُهُ عَلَيْهِ فَضْلَ هَذِهِ الْلَيَالِي وَأَنَّ فِيهَا ليلة القدر وأن فيها ليلة القدر التي هي خير من ألف شهر. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من حرم خيرها فقد حرم, يعني فهو المحروم. All of this that we find that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to strive more in the last 10 nights than at any other time, and he used to spend the entire last 10 nights awake in prayer and so on and so forth, all of this is because he realized the great value and virtues of those 10 nights, particularly because among them is the night known as Laylatul Qadr, or the night of decree. That night about which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Laylatul Qadri khayrun min alfi shahr. The night known as Laylatul Qadr, the night of decree, is greater in value in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than 1,000 months. خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ يعني لا تعدل ألف شهر وإنما هي خَيْرٌ مِنْ أَلْفِ شَهْرٍ. Not that they are equal to 1,000 months, but they are greater than 1,000 months. In greater value. بمعنى أخرى أن الذي يقوم ليلة القدر والذي يعمل أي عمل صالح في ليلة القدر فكأنما عملها لأكثر من ألف شهر, لأكثر من 83 سنة. And to put it another way, it means that anyone who stands in prayer and carries out acts of worship on that night known as Laylatul Qadr, it is recorded for them as though they did those acts for more than 1,000 months, for more than 83 years. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appreciated the value of those nights. And this is why he said, whoever is deprived of its goodness, that is the goodness of the night of decree, Laylatul Qadr, then that individual is truly deprived. لذلك يشرع لنا في الأيام العشر الأواخر من رمضان بعض العبادات مثل ماذا؟ كالاعتكاف وتحري ليلة القدر طبعا, والإكثار من تلاوة القرآن, والاجتهاد في القيام, والإكثار من الإنفاق في سبيل الله. Now because of this, there are certain things that are legislated or prescribed for us and recommended for us during the last 10 days and the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Things such as al-i'tikaf. Al-i'tikaf, we'll talk about that in just a few short moments, inshallah. And of course, searching for Laylatul Qadr and reading even more Quran and striving more in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, particularly in the night prayer, and giving more in charity. طيب, من هذه الأعمال قلنا الإكثار من تلاوة القرآن. لماذا؟ لأن فيه يعني أجرا عظيما. كلنا يعلم ذلك الحديث الذي فيه أن من قرأ حرفا من القرآن له بها 10 حسنات. So we mentioned from those deeds for us to recite more Quran. And it should be quite obvious why. Besides the fact, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ, إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ في ليلة القدر شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Besides the fact that the Quran was sent down in this month, and particularly on that night known as Laylat al-Qadr, we learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that anyone who recites even one letter of the Quran, simply one letter, then for that they will receive 10 hasanat or 10 good deeds. وَيُضَاعِفُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ. And Allah may increase that for whomever He wills. وَالْقُرْآنُ كَذَلِكَ يَشْفَعُ لِلْعَبْدِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ كَمَا ثَبَتَ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. And the Quran on the Day of Judgment will intercede on behalf of an individual who used to recite it on the Day of Qiyamah. It will intercede on their behalf. ثُمَّ ذَكَرْنَا الْإِكْثَارُ مِنَ الْإِنْفَاقِ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَهَذَا عَلَيْهِ دَلِيلٌ. فعن ابن عباس رضي الله عنه وأرضاه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس على الإطلاق. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس، لم يأته أحد يطلب حاجة إلا وأعطاه، ما منع أحدا، لم يحرم أحدا، إن كان عنده شيء أعطاه إياه. كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس، وكان أجود ما يكون في رمضان حين يلقاه جبريل، وكان يلقاه في كل ليلة من رمضان فيدارسه القرآن. فلرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود بالخير من الريح المرسلة، يعني هذه الريح التي تأتي بالخير. العرب إذا أتت هذه الريح المرسلة السريعة كانت إشارة أن هناك مطر، سيأتيهم المطر. We also mentioned increasing the amount of charity that we give. And for this we also have evidence. Because Abdullah ibn Abbas رضي الله عنهما says that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was the most generous of people. Period. He was more generous than anyone, to the extent that no one came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked him for something except that he gave it to them. If he had something to give, he would give it. If he didn't have anything, he would direct them to those who could give them. And there are many examples of that, but will suffice just by mentioning that. In any event, he was the most generous of people. And he says he was even more generous in the month of Ramadan when Jibreel alayhi salam would come to him, when he would meet him. And he, that is Jibreel alayhi salam, used to meet him every night during Ramadan to revise the Quran with him. So everything up to that point which had been revealed to him of the Quran, Jibreel alayhi salam would revise it with him. And then he said, radiyallahu anhu ardah, the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was more generous than the fast wind. Maybe many of us don't get that reference, but when the fast wind came for the Arabs, that was a sign of good coming. So that strong wind that would blow, it would indicate that rain is to come. وَذَكَرْنَا أَيْضًا الْإِعْتِكَافِ الَّذِي هُوَ اللَّبْثُ وَالْمُكْثُ فِي الْمَسْجِدِ، يعني البقاء في المسجد للعبادة. ونجد في حديث عائشة رضي الله عنها وأرضاها أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يعتكف العشر الأواخر من رمضان حتى توفاه الله، ثم اعتكف أزواجه من بعده، ثم اعتكف أزواجه من بعده. وليعلم الجميع أن الاعتكاف لا يكون إلا في المسجد، إلا في المسجد، وليس هناك اعتكاف في المصليات على سبيل المثال. الاعتكاف فقط في المسجد. We also mention الاعتكاف, which is when an individual secludes themselves in the masjid, devotes themselves to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nothing else. عائشة رضي الله عنها وأرضاها tells us that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to spend the last 10 nights of Ramadan in the masjid, in i'tikaf, secluded in the masjid. The last 10 nights of Ramadan, he would spend them there. He did that until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took him away, until he left this world. Then afterwards, his wives would also perform i'tikaf. But know that i'tikaf, this seclusion in the masjid, it's only for the masjid, it's only for the mosques. It cannot be done in Islamic centers, in a musalla, certain places that are dedicated for prayer. No, it has to be a mosque, it has to be a masjid. That is where i'tikaf, that is where i'tikaf is done. طيب. والحقيقة أن هناك فضائل كثيرة للعشر الأواخر وأنا متأكد أنكم سمعتم عنها ولكن لنسأل لماذا نحث الناس لماذا نحث أنفسنا ونحث الناس على الاجتهاد في رمضان وخاصة في العشر الأواخر من رمضان. The question now arises, I mean, look, when it comes to the virtues or the merits of the last 10 days and nights of Ramadan, I'm absolutely certain that you've read about them and you've heard them over and over and over. But at this point, we should just ask ourselves for a moment. Let's step back and ask ourselves why. Why all of this encouragement to strive so hard in the month of Ramadan? Why all this encouragement to strive even harder in the last 10 nights of Ramadan? What we need to do is go back and remind ourselves of why we are fasting. حتى نفهم هذا لابد أن نسأل أنفسنا لماذا نصوم؟ لماذا شرع لنا الله جل وعلا الصيام؟ الجواب في كتاب الله. ليس ما على ألسنة الناس على ألسنة الناس حتى نحس بجوع الفقراء والمساكين. نعم هذا من الفضائل ولكن ليس هذا السبب الذي من أجله شرع الصيام. ليس حتى نخفف من الوزن ونصح صوموا تصحوا ليس بحديث ليس بحديث ولو كان المعنى صحيحا يعني الذي يصوم يصح بإذن الله جل وعلا. كثير من الناس يخجل أن يذكر الحكمة من مشروعية الصيام فيأتي بمثل هذه الحكم. لماذا نصوم؟ قال الله جل وعلا يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون لعلكم تنالون التقوى. والتقوى ما هي التقوى؟ التقوى أن تجعل بينك وبين غضب الله وعقابه وقاية تقيك من ذلك تقيك وذلك بفعل الأوامر وترك النواهي. إذن الحكمة العظمى من الصيام لعلكم تتقون. To answer that question, let's look to the Quran and let's not listen to what the people say. We need to step back and ask ourselves, why do we fast? Well, unfortunately, many people feel shy to give the real reason behind fasting. So when you ask many Muslims today, and especially our youngsters, and of course we're the ones who corrupted them, what do they say? If they're at school, they're shy to really say why they're fasting. Why do you guys fast? Oh, so that we can feel the pain of the poor and the needy. So we can feel the hunger that they feel. I'm not saying that that's not one of the wisdoms. I'm not saying that is not one of the wisdoms. But that is not the primary reason why we fast. That is not why we fast. That is a benefit that we attain. Why do you guys fast? Oh, so we can be healthier. Because fasting is healthy. Didn't you see? Science has proven it. Science has proven it. Big deal. Big deal. That is a side benefit. I'm not saying it's not a benefit of fasting. But that is not why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated fasting for us. He didn't say to us, fast, so you lose weight and you become healthier. He didn't say to us, fast, so you can feel for the poor and the needy who are always hungry. Those are benefits that are going to come. Those are necessary, you know, fruits and results of fasting. But that is not the primary reason. The reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated fasting for us is mentioned clearly in the Quran. Allahu Jalla wa Ala tells us what means, O you who have believed. Fasting has been made mandatory for you. It has been enjoined upon you, just as it was enjoined upon those before you. كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. So that you can attain at-taqwa, so that you can attain piety, so that you can be God-conscious. At-taqwa. So the main reason is so that you will attain at-taqwa. And what is at-taqwa? At-taqwa is to place a shield or a barrier between yourself and the anger of Allah and His punishment. That barrier which will protect you. And how is that done? It is done by fulfilling your obligations towards Allah, by performing the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or the commands of Allah, and abstaining from the prohibitions. This is the primary reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated fasting for us. ثُمَّ أَيْضًا نُذَكِّرُ أَنفُسَنَا بِأَنَّنَا لَن نَبْقَى فِي هَذِهِ الدُّنْيَا وَإِنَّمَا سَنَمُوتُ يَوْمًا مِنَ الْأَيَّامِ شِئْنَا أَمْ أَبَيْنَا وَمَاذَا بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ اِعْلَمُوا عِلْمَ الْيَقِينَ أَنَّنَا بَعْدَ أَن نَمُوتُ سَنُبْعَثُ وَسَنُحَاسَبُ ثُمَّ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وفريق في السعير فريق في الجنة وفريق في السعير ولذلك في هذه الدنيا لابد أن نستغل الوقت حتى ننجو من النار من السعير قوا أنفسكم وأهليكم نارا ذكرت لكم ذلك في الأسبوع الماضي. طيب, the other thing we have to remind ourselves of is the fact that we are not going to live in this world forever. Sooner or later, whether we like it or not, we are going to leave this world. In other words, we're going to die. كل نفس ذائقة الموت. Whether we like it or not, we have to depart from this world. We will all die. It's not over. It is not over with death. أُقْسِمُ لَكُمْ بِاللَّهِ لَوْ عَلِمْنَا أَنَّهُ لَا شَيْءَ بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ لَمَا قُمْنَا بِرَكْعَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ. ليش؟ ليش أتعب نفسي؟ يعني بعد الموت ما في شيء. ما في شيء أصلاً. لا حساب. لا جزاء ولا عقاب. معناته خليني أمتع نفسي. صح ولا لا؟ Look, if you want to know the truth, if there was nothing after death, if it was over with death, I wouldn't even pray one rak'ah. Why would I? What would be the point? After death, there's nothing? There's no punishment, there's no reward, there's nothing? Let me enjoy life. Let me do whatever I want here. This is my only opportunity. Do you understand? But the reality is, it is not over with death. After we die, we will be resurrected. We will be made to stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will have to answer for everything we did in this life. After that, فَرِيقٌ فِي الْجَنَّةِ وَفَرِيقٌ فِي السَّعِيرِ. People will be divided ultimately into two groups. One group will go to al-Jannah, paradise. And the other one will go to the blazing fire, that is the fire of hell. There's only going to be two groups. So this life is all about protecting ourselves from falling into the hellfire. This is what it's all about. That's why we want to attain at-taqwa, so we can protect ourselves from falling into the hellfire. This is what life is about, striving for the hereafter. And I mentioned to you last week that ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that we need to protect ourselves and our families from that fire, that is the fire of hell. Tayyib. Now let's look when it comes to the fasting of Ramadan, when it comes to the night prayers in Ramadan. It's all intertwined. What is it that will land people in the hellfire? What will land people in the hellfire, first and foremost, of course, is disbelief. That is not believing in Allah. That is not being Muslim, not adopting al-Islam as their way of life. Then, the bad deeds or the sins that we commit. بعد ذلك ننظر في الصيام والقيام ما الهدف؟ ما الهدف؟ قلنا إنه سيكون فريق في الجنة وفريق في السعير ونحن نريد أن ننجو من السعير من النار. لماذا يدخل الناس النار؟ يدخل الناس النار بسبب الكفر، لأنهم لا يؤمنون بالله، لأنهم لم يكونوا مسلمين، لأن دينهم ليس هو الإسلام، لذلك يدخلون النار. ولكن أيضا بسبب ذنوبهم، بسبب الآثام، لذلك اسمعوا جيدا. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. وإذا غفر للعبد ما تقدم من ذنبه لن يدخل النار. أفهمتم الآن؟ So let's look at the ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says to us that whoever fasts in Ramadan, whoever observes the fasting of Ramadan out of faith in Allah, knowing that it is Allah who legislated it, who made it mandatory, and anticipating reward from him. In other words, doing it with utmost sincerity. من صام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا يعني مخلصا لوجه الله. Then their previous sins will be forgiven. And guess what? A person who doesn't have a sin to his name on the day of judgment will not enter the hellfire. They will go straight to Jannah. وكذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه ومن قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. إذن الغرض من الصيام والقيام هو العفو، مغفرة الذنوب، العتق من النار. هذا هو سبب لماذا نعمل في رمضان ولماذا نجتهد أكثر في العشر الأواخر. هذه هي الأسباب. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also told us that those who spend the nights of Ramadan in prayer, in voluntary prayer, out of faith in Allah and hoping for reward in Allah, their previous sins will be forgiven. And he said particularly also about Laylatul Qadr, whoever spends that night in prayer, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of faith and anticipating reward from Allah, their previous sins will be forgiven. So this is the purpose. This is the reason that we fast. so that we will attain these rewards, so that our sins will be forgiven, so that we will be conscious and aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so that we will be saved and protected from the hellfire. لا نريد أن نكون مثل ذلك الذي أخبر عنه النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم رب صائم حظه من صيامه الجوع والعطش ورب قائم حظه من قيامه السهر. We don't want to be that person about whom the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم warned. He said that there may be those who fast, and all they attain, all they get out of their fasting is hunger and thirst. And he said there may be those who offer the voluntary prayers at night in Ramadan, but all they get out of that is a sleepless night. We don't want to be that person. وعلينا أن ننتبه أتعرفون من أول ليلة من رمضان وإلى آخر ليلة من رمضان ينادي مناد. هذا المنادي ينادي في كل ليلة والذي قلبه حي يحس بالنداء يقول ذلك النادي يا باغي الخير أقبل ويا باغي الشر أقصر. ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ولله عتقاء من النار وذلك كل ليلة, يعني النداء هذا في كل ليلة والعتقاء في كل ليلة. إذن هذا الذي نصوم من أجله, هذا الذي نقوم الليل من أجله, نريد العتق من النار. We don't want to be that person that I mentioned, but we also want to be reminded of an announcement that started being made from the first night of Ramadan, and it will continue until the last day and the last night of Ramadan. An announcer is making an announcement, and those whose hearts are alive, those whose hearts have faith in them, they sense that announcement. That announcer says each and every night of Ramadan, O seeker of good, O you who desires to do good, proceed, move forward, do whatever good you want to do. And O seeker of evil, you who intends to do something bad, desist, hold back, don't do it. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, and every single night of Ramadan also, there are people amongst his creation whom he subhanahu wa ta'ala will write freedom for from the hellfire. This is why we fast. This is why we pray during the night of Ramadan, so that we can attain the forgiveness of Allah, so he will save us from the hellfire. أيها الأحبة في الله, هذا كله نعرفه إن شاء الله تعالى. وأقول لا ننسى ما يمر به أهلنا الآن في غزة, فكيف سيقضون ليلة القدر, وكيف سيستقبلون ليلة القدر. All of this is fine and dandy, and inshallah ta'ala we are all aware of it. But at this time I want to remind myself and the rest of you of what our brethren in Gaza are going through. Have you asked yourself, what is Laylatul Qadr going to be like for them? How are they going to receive and welcome Laylatul Qadr? وهنا أقول وكثيرا ما قلت هذا الكلام, إننا نحزن على أهل غزة, والحقيقة أنه يحزن علينا, وستعلمون لماذا الآن. You know, I have said repeatedly over the last few months that we feel sorry for the people of Gaza, but in reality it is us, we are the ones that we should feel sorry for, not the people of Gaza. لماذا؟ ها نحن مقبلون على ليلة القدر, ونحن نعاين ما يحدث لأهلنا في غزة، ولكن اعلموا رحمكم الله أن ليلة واحدة في غزة أعظم وأكبر وأفضل من ليلة القدر.
الله
يا رب. ممكن؟ ممكن هذا الكلام؟ كيف وليلة القدر خير من ألف شهر؟ We see all of what is going on. But let me give you some glad tidings. In other words, some consolation for the people of Gaza. We're about to enter the last 10 nights of Ramadan. We're excited about Laylatul Qadr. And we literally see what is happening to our brethren in Gaza. But rest assured that one single night in Gaza is greater in reward. One single night in Gaza is more virtuous. One single night in Gaza is better than Laylatul Qadr. How could that possibly be? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that Laylatul Qadr in the sight of Allah is greater in value than a thousand months. طيب ولسائل أن يقول من أين أتيت بهذا الكلام؟ كيف تقول أن ليلة في غزة أعظم وأفضل وأكبر من ليلة القدر؟ أقول هكذا تعلمنا من رسولنا صلى الله عليه وسلم. You might ask, where did you pull that out of? Which hat did you pull that out of? No. This we learn from the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. اسمعوا واسمعوا جيدا. سأذكر لكم حديثين صحيحين ثابتين. Listen well. I'm going to mention to you two sound hadith of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. يقول صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه موقف ساعة في سبيل الله خير من قيام ليلة القدر عند الحجر الأسود.
الله.
مو بس خير من قيام ليلة القدر بل وعند الحجر الأسود. تصوروا. ويقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ألا أنبئكم بليلة أفضل من ليلة القدر؟ حارس يحرس في أرض خوف لعله لا يرجع إلى أهله. Listen to these two hadith. In the first one, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says to stand watch for an hour. It doesn't literally mean an hour, for a period of time in the way of Allah, to stand guard in the way of Allah is better than standing in prayer on the night of Qadr, Laylatul Qadr, the night of decree. Not only that, but better than doing so while being at the black stone, at the Kaaba. In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, shall I not inform you of a night better than Laylatul Qadr, better than the night of decree? Then he explained, he said, a guard who stands watch in a land of fear, knowing that perhaps he will never return to his family. أسمعتم الحديثين؟ وهذا حال أهلنا في غزة حراسة في سبيل الله وموقف ساعة في سبيل ماذا؟ في سبيل حماية حرمات ومقدسات المسلمين ومقدسات المسلمين. إذن ليلة في غزة خير وأعظم وأفضل من ليلة القدر. هكذا علمنا من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. After you hear these two hadith, you say the people of Gaza. Indeed, this is the situation in Gaza. This is the condition of the people in Gaza. They are guarding in the cause of Allah. They are standing for a long time doing what? They are protecting the sanctities and the holy sites of the Muslims. So this is how we know that one night in Gaza is better than Laylatul Qadr. So do not feel sorry for the people of Gaza. Feel sorry for yourselves. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم ولسائر المسلمين فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، أيها الأخيار، في الخطبة الأولى ذكرت لكم أنه كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أجود الناس وأجود ما يكون في رمضان وأجود ما يكون في رمضان. I mentioned to you in the first khutbah, the first sermon, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was from the most generous of people. But he was even more generous during Ramadan, during the month of Ramadan. وعلمنا أن شهر رمضان شهر الصدقة شهر الصدقة. We also have learned that the month of Ramadan is a month of charity. We talked about this previously. وهناك وجوه للخير كثيرة وجوه الإنفاق في سبيل الله كثيرة. يمكننا أن ننفق على أهلنا في غزة وفي غيرها للمسلمين المستضعفين للضعفاء للفقراء للمساكين للأيتام وهكذا. ويمكننا أن ندعم مشاريع خيرية مثل دور الأيتام دور العجزة ومثل بناء المساجد. There are many good things that we can do. There are many ways to spend our wealth for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We can support our brethren in Gaza and in other places who are being subjugated to torture and starvation and so on and so forth. We can help the poor and the needy. We can help orphans. We can support causes like building schools, like supporting orphanages, and also building masajid, building mosques. أحبتي في الله لكم أن تنفقوا أموالكم في جميع هذه في هذه المشاريع. واليوم أذكركم بأن لنا مشروعا هنا هو مشروع بناء مسجد لوجه الله سبحانه وتعالى. نريد أن نؤسس مسجدا على التقوى، مسجدا تقام فيه الصلوات، مسجدا يعلم فيه أولادنا أمور دينهم، ليس مسجدا من أجل السياسة ومن أجل تغيير سياسات الحكومة. لا، نحن نريد أولا أن نبني التقوى في أنفسنا، وإن عملنا ذلك وإن نجحنا في ذلك فحتما ستتغير أمور كثيرة. Having said all of this, we can spend in all of these wonderful ways, but I'm here to remind you that we have a masjid project. We are striving to establish a masjid based on fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based on piety. A masjid in which the five daily prayers will be established. A masjid in which our children will be taught their religion so they can be decent human beings and contributing members to society. We want to establish a masjid in which Allah is remembered, in which good is taught, a masjid which will be a beacon of hope and goodness. We are not interested in establishing a masjid for the sake of politics and for the sake of changing government policies. No. We want to establish a masjid in which you and I together can grow and become better Muslims. The other things that I mentioned, to better the society, that comes as a natural result. We have this masjid project. وهذا المشروع أحث نفسي أولا ثم إياكم أن تدعموه بما استطعتم بربع دولار أو بربع مليون دولار لا بأس بما نستطيع. اسمعوا قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من بنى مسجدا لله ولو كمفحص قطاه أو أصغر بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. وهذا الحديث يدل على أن من ساعد على عمارة المسجد ولو بشيء قليل استحق هذا الثواب الجزيل. Look, there's no pressure. I say to you, whatever we are capable of, we put forth for this project. Whether it be a quarter of a dollar or a quarter million dollars, it doesn't matter. Whatever one is capable of. وَأَقَلْ مَا فِيهِ الدُّعَاءِ. And at the very least, dua. Supplicate to Allah to grant success to this project. I want you to listen carefully. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever builds a masjid, even if it is as small as a bird's nest, or even smaller, he says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah will build for that person a home in paradise. Do you know what this is saying to us? It's saying to us it doesn't matter. Even if you give a small amount, not that it's all or nothing, either you have the full amount or a huge amount to give for the masjid. No. Even if it is a small amount, you are entitled. You are entitled to that reward. وَتَذَكَّرُوا أَنَّنَا سَنَمُوتُ غَدًا وَإِذَا مَاتَ الْعَبْدُ إِنْقَطَعَ عَمَلُهُ إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاثٍ ومنها الصدقة الجارية التي يدوم الانتفاع بها حتى بعد الموت. So whatever we're able to do. And remember again what we mentioned earlier. Death will come to us sooner or later. And when we die, our deeds come to an end. Except through three things. One of those is a perpetual charity. In other words, if you donate for the building of a masjid, that is a perpetual charity because people will continue to benefit from it and you yourself will continue to benefit. وَأَخِيرًا يَقُولُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى وَمَا تُقَدِّمُوا لِأَنفُسِكُم مِّنْ خَيْرٍ تَجِدُوهُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ هُوَ خَيْرًا وَأَعْظَمَ أَجْرًا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. And my final reminder is that ayah in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what means, and whatever good you put forward for yourselves, you will find it with Allah on the Day of Judgment. Not only will you find it with Him, it will be better and greater in reward than you could even imagine. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages us to seek forgiveness. And indeed, Allah is the forgiving and the merciful. اللهم وفقنا لإدراك ليلة القدر وحيازة أعظم الأجر واجعلنا ممن ينال بركتها وسلامها يا عظيم. اللهم اجعلنا معظمين لأمرك مؤتمرين به واجعلنا معظمين لما نهيت عنه منتهين عنه. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم إنا نسألك بأسمائك الحسنى وصفاتك العلى العلا أن تعز الإسلام والمسلمين وتذل الشرك والمشركين وأن تدمر أعداء الدين. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تنصر من نصر الدين وأن تخذل من خذل الدين. اللهم كل إخواننا في كل مكان، اللهم كلهم في فلسطين وكلهم في السودان وفي سوريا وفي اليمن وفي العراق وفي بورما وفي الهند وفي كل بقعة يذكر فيها اسمك ويقتل فيها عبادك ويستضعف فيها أولياؤك الصالحين. اللهم يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث، اللهم يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث. أغث أهلنا في غزة، اللهم انصرهم بنصرك على من عاداهم يا ذا القوة المتين. اللهم سدد رميهم وثبت أقدامهم، اللهم كلهم معينا ونصيرا ومؤيدا ونصيرا، وارحم موتاهم وتقبل شهداءهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم عليك بالمجرمين من الصهاينة المعتدين ومن الصليبيين ومن وافقهم وظاهرهم من المنافقين والعملاء يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا نجعلك في نحورهم، اللهم إنا نجعلك في نحورهم ونعوذ بك من شرورهم. اللهم شتت شملهم وفرق جمعهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصرنا عليهم، اللهم انصرنا عليهم، اللهم انصرنا عليهم. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم، رحمكم الله.